Thank you for joining us on Recovered Truth today. My name is Greg Reeser, the pastor here at Crossword Bible Church. We want to extend an invitation for you to come and join us in person. And come and join and along with the study that we have on Sunday mornings. We meet at the Holiday Inn Express Conference Room. We usually meet at 10 o'clock in the morning for fellowship. By 10:30, we're going with the Bible study. At the end of each one of these videos, we have our email address and a phone number. And one thing that I do want to mention to you that I've not mentioned before is if you would like to meet with us, let us know, and we'll make sure that we can get you here. Also, if you don't have a Bible, let us know. We'll get you a King James Bible. Just call us or email us, and we'll get one out to you. And hopefully that can get you on the right track to where you can actually start studying the Bible. And we'll take a look at that, those types of things a little bit more as we go on later on. But today what I want to talk about is God's official stance, God's official position today. And this is something that a lot of folks don't really think about or realize. But what I want to do, notice Romans chapter 1. We're going to read some verses here and then we're going to get into the study. But Romans chapter 1, verse 1, starts off, says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated under the gospel of God. Verse 2, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. By whom we have received grace and apostleship for the obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ. Verse 7. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So what I want you to think about today is God's official stance with the world as we see it today. There, it really comes down to two things: grace and peace. That's God's official stance today. And that's what we want to be able to focus on today. If you go through every one of Paul's epistles, he starts off with grace and peace. In fact, go with me real quick. We'll just do a couple of these very quickly. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So what I want us to know here is, where is this grace coming from? Grace is from the Father, and peace from, as he says here, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. That's God's official stance today. Is God is putting out grace and peace. The way that he's doing, the way he's putting this grace out is through himself. And the way that he's showing peace is through the Lord Jesus Christ. You can go through each one of Paul's epistles. Now, there are a couple where he adds on mercy. All right? So you have grace, peace, and mercy. That's God's official stance today. Now, what I want us to do is take a look at a couple things real quick. Go get Revelation chapter 19. Get Revelation chapter 19 in one hand. And we're going to get Psalm chapter 2 in the other. Alright, so Revelation chapter 19 in one hand, and Psalm chapter 2 in the other. And I want us to take a look at the difference here between these verses and what we just got through reading in Paul's epistles there. So Psalm chapter 2 and Revelation chapter 19. Notice, Revelation chapter 19. Hopefully, we do know a little bit about what's going on in the passages here. One of the things that I want to point out is, in time past, God made a difference between the Jew and the Gentile. And all that was, everything in the time past, according to Ephesians chapter 2, that was the issue there. We have the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. You have the Holy Spirit coming down on the day of Pentecost with Peter and the 11. Then you have the fall of Israel in Acts chapter 7 with the stoning of Stephen. And from that point on, you have the diminishing of the nation of Israel down to where they're going to be on the exact same playing field as the Gentiles. And that's what God's doing today through the dispensation of the grace of God. Whether you're a Jew or a Gentile, all are under sin. All have the ability to be saved now. We don't have to go through a particular group of people. All we got to do is go through what the Bible says and find out what God's doing today. And at the end of this dispensation, you're going to have the rapture of the church, the body of Christ. After that rapture, you're going to have the 70th week of Daniel, the seven years of tribulation period. The Bible calls it Jacob's trouble. At the end of that 70th week of Daniel, you're going to have the second coming of Christ. And what Christ is going to do is he's going to bind Satan in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. And Jesus Christ is going to rule and reign on the earth for 1,000 years in that millennial kingdom. At the end of that millennial kingdom, Satan is going to be loosed for a season. And then what God's going to do is he's going to take death, hell, and the grave, put all of them along with Satan into the fire. Into that fire. That baptism that we talked about a few weeks ago in Matthew chapter 3, that's the baptism of fire back here. And then what God's going to do is he's going to set up his kingdom here on this earth in a literal, visible, physical, earthly Davidic kingdom vested in the nation of Israel with Christ sitting on the throne. So what I want you to think about where we are in Revelation chapter 19, we're over here. All right, so what is it that God's going to be doing in Revelation 19? Notice verse 11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. Now this is the second coming of Christ. So this is at the end of the tribulation period. You've got the second coming of Christ. You've got this white horse. And the one that's sitting on him, his name is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness, notice, he doth judge and make war. Now I want you to think about that real quick. What's the opposite of grace? Judge. What's the opposite of peace? War. God's official stance today in the dispensation of the grace of God is grace and peace. And the person that's bringing that grace is the Father. The person that's bringing the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ. There will come a day when He will judge and make war. That's over here. That's going to be God's official stance during that time period. Now what we need to know and understand of what God is doing today, we need to make sure that we pay attention to those things as we continue on going through and studying God's Word. Notice in verse 12, His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had written and had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Now, what that should automatically do is make you think of John chapter 1. John chapter 1, we find out what? In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. So when we see here the Word of God, notice that's a capital T and a capital W if you've got the right Bible. And you've got the Word of God, which is, of course, Jesus Christ. That's who's coming down. That's that second coming of Jesus Christ. And at that time, it's going to no longer be grace and peace, but it's going to be wrath and judgment and war. You notice there, notice about his vesture, verse 13. And he was clothed with a vesture, notice, dipped in blood. We're going to take a look at some things and find out why his vesture was dipped in blood. Verse 14. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen. Notice, white and clean. Notice, theirs is white and clean. Verse 15. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. When Jesus Christ comes back, you're not going to have this grace and peace anymore. You're going to have judgment, war. You're going to have fighting and battles. Notice verse 15. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword. What is it that can come out of your mouth that's kind of like a sword? Go over to Hebrews chapter 4. This is something that you should think about as we go through this stuff, right? If he says over here in Revelation 19, out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that it should smite the nations, what is it that's coming out of his mouth that could be a sharp sword? Well, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. For the word of God is quick and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the divide and sunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow. And it is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in the sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. What is it that's coming out of his mouth? It's his word. You realize that when Jesus Christ comes back at the second coming, this book still has to be around. You realize that God has promised to preserve his word throughout the ages so that you and I can have it and handle it now. Not only that, but it's going to be heard out there. He's going to come quoting scripture. Not new scripture, what we have right here. What we're able to have here, we're told the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. So if he's got a two-edged sword coming out of his mouth, what's that going to be? It's going to be the word. And we go back to Revelation 19, verse 15, he says, and out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it, with that sharp sword, with those words, what's he going to do? He should smite the nations. You know what? You know, in Scripture, that term nations is also Gentiles. So, when we think about what's going on, what God's offering Gentiles today is grace and peace. What he's going to offer Gentiles then is going to be judgment and war. That's probably not a good thing if you're part of that group. Go over to Psalm chapter 2. Psalm chapter 2, verse 1. We'll start off in verse 1. Psalm 2, 1. Why do the heathen rage, and the people imagine a vain thing? I want you to notice that there's two different groups of people there. Notice in Psalm 2 he says, why do the heathen rage, the Gentiles down here, and the people, that's the nation of Israel, there's a difference there in the book of Psalms between Jew and Gentile. By the way, when you understand that, and you're reading something in Psalm, for instance, Psalm 91 is a friendly verse to a lot of folks today. Psalm 91 is not talking to you. I hate to be the person to break that to you, but Psalm 91 is not a promise that you can ask God to fulfill for you today in your life, in the dispensation of the grace of God. Now, I find that might be hard for most people to hear, but that's the facts. Where are you in the book of Psalm? Right there. Why do the heathen rage? That's where you would have been. And the people imagine a vain thing. Notice, the kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. What I find very fascinating here is, notice, the kings of the earth set themselves. The rulers that we have in the world right now set themselves there. A lot of people go and they quote Romans and some other passages and talk about how God has ordained those powers. And they'll say that so-and-so's in this office because God put him there. No, he didn't. God created the position. God didn't put the people there. Notice, the kings of the earth set themselves. They're the ones that put themselves. And the rulers take counsel together and they're going to say something. Notice, let us take their bands, verse 3, asunder and cast away their cords from us. Notice God's response. He that setteth in the heavens shall laugh. You know what God's doing? He's saying, you think you've got things figured out here. God's sitting there and he's laughing. And notice he says, the Lord shall have them in derision. They think that they've got things figured out. They think that they can rule some stuff. Notice verse 5. We'll see it here. Same thing that we read back in Revelation 19. Verse 5. Then shall he, what's that next word? Speak. He shall speak to them where? In his wrath. Do you know what he's going to speak? In his wrath. That's not what he's doing today. Do you know what God's doing today? He's withholding his wrath. Paul calls it long suffering. We're going to take a look at that here in a little bit. But notice, and vex them in his sore displeasure. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. There's going to be a time where Jesus Christ is going to sit on that kingdom, in that throne, in that kingdom. I will declare the decree the Lord hath said unto me, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. You go over to Acts chapter 13. This verse right here is quoted in Acts 13. And he's talking about the resurrection of Christ. Do you know what we find out about the resurrection of Christ? That's when he's begotten. Do you know when we're going to be begotten? At the catching away. That rapture. Where our body is going to be changed. Our vile body is going to be changed. And fashioned unto like his glorious body. That's going to be an amazing day. At that time, we're going to be declared the sons of God, just as Christ was at his resurrection. That's a great thing to look forward to. Not only do we have grace, peace, and mercy, but God's going to do something in and through us that was never before talked about, never before prophesied, never before spoken about. It was kept secret. So, we've talked about this before. You've got the mystery, and you've got prophecy. That's the way that God tells us to divide the scriptures. That's the proper way to do it. Mystery, there was no time that God was going to reveal that he was going to give grace and peace and mercy through the death, burial, and resurrection of his son. But it was always prophesied judgment and war and wrath. We can go throughout the Old Testament scriptures and find that. Go over to Romans chapter 5, verse 7. Romans chapter 5, verse 7. For scarcely a righteous man will one die. Yet peradventure, for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. So, when we talk about this, that's one of the verses that allows us to know and understand that we're not going to go through that wrath, that 70th week of Daniel, the seven years of tribulation, Jacob's trouble. We're not going to be going through that. We shall be saved from wrath through him. Notice, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God. Hold your place there. Go to Psalm chapter 110 real quick. Psalm 110. And let's take a look at what would have happened had we stayed enemies with God. When we start talking about that word reconcile and reconciliation and all that stuff, there's actually four different types of reconciliation. Now that's not the issue with today's message, and we'll talk about that some other time, but I want you to notice something real quick. In Romans chapter 5, verse 10, it says, for if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son. Notice when we go to Psalm 110. What was God's official position back in Psalm 110? The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. What's He going to do with His enemies there? Make Him His footstool. Isn't that different than what we read over in Romans? Romans chapter 5, what's he do? Even when we were enemies, he reconciled us to God. Notice, keep on going. Now, of course, hopefully you know and understand that what's taking place here in Psalm 110. When Christ goes to sit on the right hand of God the Father after the ascension, he goes and sits at the right hand of the Father, and that's when Stephen sees Christ. He sees him standing. There's only one reason that Jesus Christ is going to be standing. And everybody that was around knew. He's no longer sitting. He's now standing. Stephen sees him standing up. And he's going to come back to do what? To judge, make war, bring wrath. But he didn't. Because God had a mystery purpose. Something that he kept secret in himself. That he's now going to put on display. Grace, peace, and mercy. Notice. Verse 2. The Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power, in the beauties of holiness, from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of thy youth. The Lord hath sworn and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Psalm 110, verse 5. Verse 5. The Lord at thy right hand shall strike through kings in the day of his wrath. How is he going to strike through kings? What's the sword that we read about over in Revelation 19 that he's going to use to strike through the kings? Is what? His word. His word. When he speaks the word out, what's he going to do? He's going to strike through kings in that day of his wrath. That wrath's going to come to an end, and he's going to come and he's going to judge and make war. Verse 6, he shall judge among the heathen. He shall fill the places with the dead bodies. Do you know why his vesture is dipped in blood? There it is. Notice, he shall wound the heads over many countries. He shall drink of the brook and the way. Therefore shall he lift up the head. Now when you think about that, that's going to be a bad time to be alive if you're here on the earth. But there's something extra that's going on. Go back over to Romans chapter 5. There's something that God's doing today so you don't have to be a part of that. Romans chapter 5 verse 10. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. We don't have to go through that stuff because of what God's doing today. The problem is we need to know and understand when all this took place. We'll go over to Romans chapter 11. What we see in Romans chapter 11, starting off in verse 11, we find out that God's doing something today that was never talked about, never prophesied. It was kept secret and hidden himself until the day that he revealed it to and through the Apostle Paul. Notice Romans 11, verse 11. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? In the context there, the they is the nation of Israel. Should they stumble that they should fall? God forbid. There's a time when they fall, or they stumble, but they don't fall. Have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid. But rather through their fall. So they stumble. We find out in Romans chapter 9 that Jesus Christ was a stumbling block. A rock of offense. They stumbled at the cross, and then they fell with the stoning of Stephen. You've got three different times. They deny God the Father when they have John the Baptist beheaded. They deny the Son when they have Jesus Christ crucified. And they deny the Holy Spirit when they stone Stephen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, they deny Him. He moves on. Notice. But rather, through their fall, salvation is coming to the Gentiles for to provoke them to jealousy. Do you know the purpose that God sent in salvation to you and I today, apart from the nation of Israel, is to provoke them to jealousy? That's what Paul was doing in the book of Acts, from Acts 9 to Acts 28. If you understand what's going on in the book of Acts, then your Bible is going to be a whole lot clearer. Notice, verse 13. For I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify mine office. If by any means I may provoke to emulation them which are in my flesh, and might save some of them. For if the casting away of them be the reconciling of the world, what shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead? Now what I want you to know and understand is what God's doing today through the body of Christ. You've got the body of Christ. Your apostle is Paul. It's not Peter. It's not any of the 11. Your apostle is Paul. If you want to know what God's doing today, get in the book and find out what God's doing. Everybody says, well, I want to be in the middle of God's will. And then they say, well, I'm going to go and pray to God that He shows me His will. You know, if God was speaking today, He would tell you to read the book. Read the Bible. Paul says, whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. That's why I say, if you don't have a King James Bible, let us know. We'll get one to you. I want to thank you for joining us today. And until next time, grace and peace.